Because there are so many different ways you could go about measuring a variable, it's important that you know if your method is a good one. Now, the researchers have developed two general criteria for evaluating the quality of a measurement procedure. Those two criteria are the validity, which simply put is, are you actually measuring what you think you're measuring? And the reliability, which is, are you getting the same measurement every time you use that measurement procedure? So the first one that I wanted to talk about is that reliability, which you could just simply define as the consistency of your measure. So if the same individuals are measured under the same conditions, a more reliable measurement procedure will produce similar measurements. Of course, no measurement device is perfect, and there will be some dissimilarity between your measurements, and we refer to that as error, or just which you can define as like the inconsistency of your measurement. So error can be mathematically defined as the measured score being equal to the true score of that variable plus error. And there's lots of different ways that you could assess reliability, and there's lots of different sources for error. For example, that error could come from the observer. So the individual who's making those measurements, they might use the measurement device improperly, you know, just simple human error, researcher bias. The error could also come from changes in the environment. So maybe the first time you measured that person, it was a little bit cooler than it is later in the day, or they were a little bit brighter in the room, or maybe there's some kind of weird smell that was introduced after lunchtime and now it's really throwing your participants off. You know, changes in the environment like that. And then the third source of that error could be the participants themselves. Like maybe they've changed in some substantial way that's throwing off your measurements. Maybe they've gotten hungry, maybe they've gotten bored, maybe they've gotten tired or angry about something. But there's something going on in that person that's just making your measurement device less accurate. And when it comes to the various ways of assessing your reliability, one of the more common methods is called test-retest reliability, which measures the consistency of your measurement across time. This is the one that most people are very familiar with. Like, let's say you want to measure your weight. So you step on a bathroom scale at home and you ask yourself when you see the number, you're like, is that accurate? You know, did I actually gain that much weight in the last like 2 days or whatever? So you question the accuracy of your measurement device. So you step off the bathroom scale, you wait for a moment, and then you step back on again, and it gives you the exact same number. Well, you've just used test-retest reliability. You're making sure your measurement device is accurate by trying again and trying again. Maybe you just keep getting off and getting back on again because it just doesn't seem like that's what your weight should be. But what you're doing in this case is test-retest reliability. You're just comparing the scores of successive measurements of the same individual on the same variable. And typically, if we get very similar scores, like if we get a Pearson's R correlation coefficient of greater than 0.8, then that would indicate a good amount of reliability. But there's other ways to measure reliability, such as internal consistency. So this is the consistency of an individual's response across multiple items on a multiple item measure. So let's say you take a math test, right? And it's got 100 questions, and all 100 questions are on multiplication, just various multiplication questions. So you could take that test over again many, many times. Like you could take the same 100 question test 5 times to measure its test-retest reliability, or you could just do it once with and use internal consistency. So the way you would do that is by basically splitting the test and comparing it to itself. This is something we call split half reliability. So you would take maybe the first 50 questions of that math test and compare it to the last 50 questions. And if the person's performance is roughly equal across those two halves, then that would indicate a good test, a good measurement of a person's math ability in this example. Or maybe you could compare the even numbered questions to the odd numbered questions, whatever. The whole idea here is you're splitting the test in half and you're comparing it to itself. But there's another way you could do this kind of internal consistency. It's by using what we call parallel forms reliability. So this is where instead of creating one math test and comparing it to itself, you create multiple equivalent math tests. So you compare scores by obtaining data from two or more alternate versions of a measurement procedure of the same individual. So this has some benefits and some drawbacks. The obvious drawback is that a single person is going to have to take multiple complete math tests. So they'd be answering, you know, a full set of 100 questions followed by another full set of 100 questions, but they'd be different questions. And the whole idea here is if these tests are accurately measuring their math ability, they should perform equally well on both. So that's how parallel forms reliability works. Another one that we commonly use when it comes to things like doing a naturalistic observation, so you know, when researchers go out into the real world and they observe people's behavior under realistic conditions, is something we call inter-rater reliability. So this measures the extent to which different observers are consistent in their judgments. Or you could define it as the degree of agreement between two observers who simultaneously record measurements of behaviors. So this is something I have a lot of personal experience with. When I was an undergraduate in psychology, I was recruited to a research lab where we would watch videos of patients' behavior, and we would record certain traits on various measurement scales. And I was just one of many. So what the researcher was doing is they were having a large number of undergraduates like me all rate these people's behavior, and then they would basically put all the different raters' scores together to try to get the most accurate measurement of that behavior. Because this makes sense. Like, if you want to get a very accurate measurement of somebody's behavior and you only have one person give you that data, that person might make a mistake. That person might be biased. That person might give you unreliable data. But if you have 10 people give you the same data set, you can identify those bad raters. You can identify those times where a person probably fell asleep or something because the data doesn't match up with what everybody else was doing. So inter-rater reliability is exceptionally important in these kinds of cases where there is a judgment call to be made, and it's maybe not incredibly clear as to exactly what behaviors should be assigned with which scores. So those are just a few examples of the kinds of ways we can measure reliability. That other quality criteria I mentioned at the beginning of the video is validity, the degree to which the measurement procedures, or the degree to which the measurement process measures the variable it claims to measure. In other words, like, for example, does an IQ test actually measure intelligence? You know, that's what we want it to measure, but is it actually doing that in an accurate way? And there's four different ways we can assess the validity of a measurement procedure. The first one is face validity, and this is the least scientific way to measure validity. It simply concerns whether a measurement procedure appears to measure what it claims to measure. So this is where you quite literally, you just look at the measurement procedure and you ask yourself, does this seem like it would measure this thing that I'm interested in? Like, do these questions, do they seem to be related to the construct, to the variable I'm interested in? So here's an example. The IAT is a test of a person's attitudes towards various social groups. So when you take the IAT, that's what we're trying to measure. We're trying to measure your attitude, your belief, your prejudice Or to put it simply, when you take the IIT, we're trying to figure out how much of a racist you are. That's the whole idea. So we would want a test of racism to have people judge race. And that's exactly what the test does. It involves categorizing people into different groups. So clearly, this has a high face validity. If we want to assess how racist a person is, we would want to see them act racist. Makes sense. But not all tests have such clear face validity. Some tests might leave you scratching your head wondering, what do these questions have to do with the variable I'm interested in? Like, why does this personality test ask me what my favorite kind of soda is, for example? Because that's clearly not related. That would be poor face validity in that case. The next kind of validity is called content validity, or sometimes called construct validity. This refers to the extent to which a measurement procedure covers the construct of interests, or to put it another way, how well does this describe and explain how the construct relates and interacts with other variables? So this kind of validity is based on many research studies and grows gradually as we learn more and more about the construct. So the whole idea here is, does your measurement procedure, does it help us to understand this construct in a more complete way? Does it add to the knowledge that we've already gained? Are we, you know, contributing something new here that is in line with what we've done before? That's the whole idea of content or construct validity. Then there's criterion validity or convergent validity. This refers to the extent to which people's scores on a measure are correlated with other variables that we would expect them to correlate with. So for example, if you develop an accurate measurement of relationship quality, we would expect that measurement to also measure things like the quality of a sexual relationship and the quality of emotional intimacy and things like that, because all those things tend to go together. So if your new operational definition to measure relationship quality, if it is accurate, it should measure all of those things because those things converge. And then the last form of validity I wanted to mention is discriminant validity, which is pretty much the opposite of the last one, or you could also call it divergent validity. So this is a type of validity that is demonstrated by showing no correlation between measurements of different constructs. So for example, a measurement of happiness should not show a strong correlation with income or relationship quality or job satisfaction, because happiness is not the same thing as those other things. Like, if we don't have a good measurement of happiness, then it might factor in some of that other stuff, but that other stuff we don't care about. We want a measure of happiness, so we need to make sure it's just happiness and not anything else. So those are the basic kinds of measurement of ways you could assess validity, but there's others too. Just to mention a couple others briefly, there's concurrent validity, where scores are obtained from a new measure are directly related to scores obtained from previously established measures, and predictive validity, where scores are obtained from a measure whether or not they actively, you know, like accurately predict behavior according to a theory. So reliability and validity are those two really important quality criteria, and they have a relationship. Both are obviously important, and while they do have a lot in common, they are only partially independent. What I mean is, for a measurement device to be valid, it has to be reliable. But while reliability is a prerequisite for validity, it doesn't go the other way. So for it to be valid, it must be reliable, but for it to be reliable, it does not have to be valid. So just think of it this way. If you want to accurately measure a person's weight, then it's, if you develop a method to accurately measure a person's weight, it should give them the same answer every time, right? Like if it's actually measuring their weight, it should give them the same answer if it's accurate. But just because it's always giving the same answer, that doesn't necessarily mean it's accurate. Like if you step on a scale and instead of giving you your weight, it gives you your height, well, that would be reliable. You know, every time you step on it, it gives you the same answer, but it's not measuring weight, it's measuring height. You know, it's reliable in this case, but it's completely invalid. We don't care about height. We want to measure your weight, and it keeps telling you 6 feet tall. You see what I mean? So just because something is reliable, that doesn't mean it's valid.